afternoon, you will learn about Orlando's madness, which is all the fault of the elusive Angelica. To be fair, he's not the only one. She leaves a trail of broken hearts behind her as she traipses through the poem. But the words you've just heard are from very near the beginning of the poem, as Ariosto is setting out the store as regards courtly love. As long as your lady is worthy, it doesn't matter how nasty she is. Angelica seems to take this as read, but we rather get the impression that Ariosto thinks that there are better ways for everyone to behave. Rory's Madrigal is one of the earliest published settings of Orlando Furioso, and it's probably amongst the first works that he wrote for the Ferrarese court. My hunch is that it was written for the two princesses, Anna and Lucrezia, to perform in front of delegations, the delegations sent to organize their marriages. The girls were daughters of the Este family, the rulers of Ferrara, and the dedicatees of the poem. They were certainly worthy young women, and the court didn't want their intended princes to give up hope during the many, many months that it took to organize the marriages. But they weren't Angelicas, no, no. They were much more like the real heroine of the romance, Bradamante, the warrior princess, and the fictional progenitrix of the Este. Bradamante has a lot to put up with in the poem, particularly her eventual husband, Ruggiero's gallivanting around, being chivalrous to everyone but her. But very early on, her destiny is revealed to her, so I guess she decides that it's worth playing the long game. Still, he drives her bonkers, and she breaks down more than once, worrying that he's faithless, but still not able to help herself. Her long laments were favourites for Renaissance composers, and so we're going to give you two settings, a short single verse by Jacques de Verge, and a setting of a much longer duet setting by Claudia Merrill from two of her most important and popular laments.
Thank you.
take a moment to reflect on what it meant to sing her words. As the progenitress of the estate, she was a model for estate wives and daughters who were expected to emulate her feat by bearing lots of estate babies to rule the world. Anna, in fact, did exactly this. Through her marriage to the Duke de Guise, she was the grandmother and the great-grandmother of kings, and in fact, most of the current rulers in Europe are descended from her. Settings of Bradamante's words are prominent in the magical book produced for Anna to take to France, and princesses modeled on Bradamante lamented their way through the drama staged at Anna's engagement party. And after this, there was a lamenting princess at virtually every estate wedding for the rest of the century. And this actually moves on into celebrations of other weddings, like the famous Lamento d'Arianna by Monteverdi. Merlot's lament here, I'm certain, was part of the entertainments for the wedding of Duke Alfonso II of Ferrara and Margherita Gonzaga d'Este, whose ladies eventually became the famous Concerto delle Donne. And they would have sung this piece. So this scenario may also account for settings of other of Ariosto's prominent lamentos, such as Olympia. Olympia, in the story, is chained to a rock as a sea monster sacrifice. After being abandoned by her husband, Bereno, after a one-night stand, which is actually her wedding night, too. Poor Olympia. This is an important point, and it binds her to other famous lamentos like Arianna and Monteverdi's Ninfa in the Lamento della Ninfa. These women are out of their minds because they've been introduced to sexual desire, but no longer have a way of dealing with it. Olympia has a happy ending, though, which is just as well. And these two stories, these two settings, deal with the story in a different way. Vex just describes her beauty and her sadness. There she is, lovely. But the setting attributed to Monteverdi is a full-blown lament that should remind you of Arianna's in its own wild drama.
Thank you.
poetry, stemming from the very early settings that you heard earlier on. But even more fundamentally, one of Bradamante's laments gave its name to one of the most ubiquitous chord patterns of the Renaissance, the Ruggiero bass. It's not named after Ruggiero, but after the beginning of Bradamante's plea for Ruggiero to be faithful, Ruggiero fa sempre fuitare servolo, in Canto 61. Like a 12-bar blues, the pattern was used for improvising songs and presumably was often used to accompany performances of Bradamante's laments. The pattern formed the basis of hundreds of works in the centuries after Orlando Furioso was published, and here we perform two. One, by Diego Ortiz, is an instrumental decoration of the bass pattern itself, and the second is a duet by Sigismondo d'India, which, although it doesn't set Bradamante's words, echoes his sentiment. You are an epic heroine. In fact, you're all epic heroines.